intellectual curiosity, an enormous pleasure in research and in working with young people, an endless energy. That was Professor Serge Daan. Serge Daan was a specialist in sleep rhythms in animals and in humans. And he dominated the field of behavior biology from 1975 until his retirement from this university in 2005. Serge Daan was also the recipient of numerous international awards. For instance, he received the prestigious International Prize for Biology from the Japanese Emperor himself. Serge spent his early academic career at the University of Amsterdam, where he received his PhD with honors in 1973. He went on to Andag, Bavaria, to the Max Planck Institute, and from there to the University of Stanford in the US, before finally joining the University of Groningen, also the alma mater of his dad.
My father was a radiologist by training. He studied here in Groningen at the university. My mother was a medical student by training, but she went into the science direction. And she was pretty successful. She produced this book in the 1920s, Anatomische Untersuchungen. And she won a big prize for it from the University of Amsterdam.
While his mother sacrificed her career to raise the family, Serge's father worked as a doctor at a clinic in the east of the country, near Deventer. Here, the Daan children spent a happy childhood, surrounded as they were by the academic and humanist environment their parents created for them. A very special project that his parents worked on during the 50s was the so-called kleedje. It was based on the famous tapis de Bayeux, 40 meters long, but instead of war, it depicted the evolution of mankind through the ages. Serge's parents designed and embroidered this 40 meter long tapestry themselves.
Amsterdam was the place to be for a young guy. That was my friends also went there, and I wanted to be in the city and in the place in the Netherlands where things happened. I chose biology more or less by accident, and I never regretted it. I think it's the most fascinating aspect of the sciences. Because in biology, you ask always two questions and not one. In physics, you ask, how come? In biology, you ask how, but also why? What is the evolutionary background of all what we are and what we do and what animals do? So, I found that fascinating. We did lots of things as students. I was so excited. And you could do things, you could find out, you could do measurements. I went with my friend Vincent van Leyer to the Aegean Islands while I was a student. And we were going to elaborate the distribution of the different species of reptiles and amphibians on these islands, and wrote several publications about it. And I also was a teaching assistant with a famous Dutch writer who was a biologist, Dick Helenius, at the University of Amsterdam. He was the conservator of the the department of in the museum, the Zoological Museum of Amphibians and Reptiles. I was so happy. I really had found my line of thought. The lasting interest became timing of behavior. And that started in my PhD research, which was on hibernation in bats. Well, if you see the bats hanging from the ceiling, I put little marks on their head and reconstruct their life underground. They go underground in order to survive the winter. Why should they be active at all? Why should they go from one place to the next? And when do they do that? Silly questions, maybe. And I wrote my thesis about this, and I did, in addition, I did in the lab on other species, I did also work on hibernation, and that yielded me the cum laude degree in 1973.
An important event, however, had already occurred in 1968, when Serge attended a conference in Bohemia, south of Prague. It was organized by two young Czech scientists, just a few days after the Russian invasion.
And I called the organizers and asked them, do you want us to come? And they said, yes, please. Yes, please. That's the one thing we need now, is contact with the West. They were so happy that we were there, but the conference was over in one morning. We had given our talks, and then we promised them that we would hold the second conference in their turn in Amsterdam 2 years later. So that's what I did.
That second conference in 1970 would lead to the pivotal meeting in the life of Serge Daan. Scientists of the Max Planck Institute of Southern Germany came to Amsterdam, and one of them was the leading scientist Gerhard Heldmeier, who would later become the president of the Deutsche Forschungsgesellschaft. And it was Heldmeier who introduced Serge to Jürgen Aschoff.
And I visited him there in his home, in that little Bavarian village, under the leadership of Professor Jürgen Aschoff. As something I learned from him right away, Aschoff always had his door open from his office. I've done that all the rest of my life. Never a closed door to my office. He is one of the founders of biological timing research. He ran that institute, and I was introduced to him, and he said, sit down, and what are you interested in? What are you doing? And so, and I was telling him about my hibernation research, and he got enthusiastic. And at the end of the day, he said, okay, let's draft Alexander von Humboldt's stipend. And so it went. He was the leader in that field because he, as a medical doctor, he had surrounded himself with biologists because he knew that the biologists have the real analytical and experimental approaches. And it was in a general biological institute where Konrad Lorenz, for instance, he had a different department, was. But he said, well, that biological clock, which had become apparent in many animal studies, he said, we do have to know whether that also works in humans. And he built, in his new institute, he built a bunker underground to have complete isolation and to have subjects there whom he could study, so that he could study the biological clock in humans. And that is his major contribution to science. How are they entrained to the 24 hours of the rotation of the Earth? This is a property of, a very fundamental property of life on Earth. And Ashoff found out in his bunker where about 500 people have spent over the years, maybe 3 or 4 weeks at a time to do a complete experiment, to follow the precise times of waking up and going to bed and all sorts of different physiological changes which occur in the course of the day. He was the leading person, and I was so happy that I could work there.
Jürgen Ashoff had an equally famous colleague at the other side of the pond. It was Colin Pittendrick from Stanford University in the US. And after 2 years with Jürgen Ashoff, Serge went on to California to join Colin Pittendrick.
And I spent 2 years with him in Stanford. Those were among my most productive years in science, and I really got into this whole field. The end of it was, besides a lifelong friendship with Colin Pittendrick, which was fantastic, it was also that we produced at the very end, not the book we had initially conceived, but a series of 5 papers, a functional analysis of circadian pacemakers in nocturnal rodents, all based on mice, hamsters, little creatures. And we really analyzed how light and experience and affects the biological clock, and how it takes care of letting the living world, the animals, run in synchrony with the rotation of the Earth. That is the essence of a biological clock, that it is adjusted. It creates a behavior which prepares animals and plants to the rotation of the Earth and to the alternation of light and darkness. But when that came out, it was really treated by the emerging world of chronobiology as some people called it the 5 books of Moses, which we had written. And it was being used all over the place by labs around the world as sort of standard literature for courses for students who wanted to get into that field, because it was so fascinating that in the brain of animals is something which ticks, and that there is a watch which controls our behavior, and then, due to Ashoff, also human behavior. These 2 postdoc experiences before I came to Groningen gave me friendships for life, not only with the 2 popes themselves, but also with their offspring.
At age 35, Serge decided to return to Holland and to set up his own group. He had been able to acquire a fantastic farm near the Lauwersmeer, a nature reserve in the north of Holland. And of course, the major attraction was this University of Groningen. Here, Gerard Barends had brought zoology to the next level by bringing in all sorts of other disciplines, such as ethology, endocrinology, and ontogeny. Serge started by joining the group of Rudy Drent and was soon enough able to set up his own group.
My time in Groningen, and it was for me wonderful because I had great students. I had a batch of PhD students Dirk-Jan Masman and Cor Dijkstra and Theo Meyer, who all worked on kestrels, little birds of prey, and their timing of behavior on a daily basis, which is related to how many mice are there, how many voles, I should say, are above ground, because that's their prey. And we did that in the Lauwers Meer area, and we tabulated that, and found that they could time their behavior based on their experience with the presence of these animals. And they also, it went also as far as the timing of their reproduction in the course of the year. So this was all timing research, involved a great deal of energy measurements, and that was fantastic experience.
Meanwhile, Serge's research with Jürgen Aschoff continued. A breakthrough came in 1980 at a conference near Munich. Here at Schloss Ringberg, at the southern shores of the Tegernsee, Alex Borbély of the University of Zurich and Anna Wiertz of the University of Basel presented exciting papers. Jürgen Aschoff had found in his bunker experiments that humans, once they are isolated from the outer world, seem to be subject to a different rhythm. It led to the hypothesis that instead of one, there are maybe two pacemakers in the brain. Now, Serge's experiments with birds and their prey had pointed in that same direction. And at this conference in Schloss Ringberg, Alex Borbély presented a paper that confirmed these findings.
When he told that, I got so excited, because I thought, well, then the whole problem is perhaps solved. We don't need a pacemaker for this. This is simply an oscillation which does this, but does so with different intensities. And some people may sleep slowly, and others may sleep fast. And the conditions may affect the rate of sleeping. So that was the essence of the new idea which came up. And after his talk at lunchtime, I remember that I immediately joined Alex and Anna, who was also into this, at the lunch table, and we started talking about this and drawing figures. And I thought, well, suddenly we are a step further. We know much better if we can formalize this. This whole thing led to tremendous excitement and activity on the field of sleep. Because what Alex and I did, we published a major paper in 1984 on the whole model, including lots of data present in the literature which we could explain with this. And that is among my most cited papers.
Through Alex Borbély and Anna Wiertz, Serge met Professor Rudy van der Hoofdakker, a psychiatrist at Groningen University, in Holland better known under the poet name Rutger Copland. Van der Hoofdakker became a close collaborator of Serge, as did his colleague Domien Beersma, who was a biophysicist in the psychiatry department.
In the beginning, I spent lots of time myself in the psychiatry department to help with the research there, with modeling. But later on, I tried to get Domien over to biology. After all, he was a biophysicist. And the end of it was that by bits and pieces, 1/10 at a time, he was moved over to biology, and he became eventually my successor in this particular field.
Serge's academic memories include his criticism of the Dutch system of academic careers, which used to be very different from the tenure track system in the US. But when Serge became vice dean, with Douwe Beersma as his dean of the faculty, they saw their opportunity.
I have suffered from this. I've always been in a dependent position under the boss in animal ecology, and I worked on human sleep. But later on, when I became vice dean of the faculty, Douwe Beersma, whom I respected a great deal, he was the dean, and he asked me to be vice dean, and we immediately hooked up together, and we said we are going to introduce in our faculty the tenure track system.
Another innovation that Serge helped implementing were the so-called Rosalind Franklin fellowships. They were meant to promote women in professorships and were therefore only open for female applicants. The program was an immediate success for this university and continues to do well.
We were the very first to start this, to start get away from affirmative action, but do something about it. And that was extremely successful. And I remember the excitement with the quality of the applications, because we asked applications for it from the whole world. And I think we had 20 positions or so, but for free. And then year after year, we repeated that until the whole university took over the Rosalind Franklin fellowships. Collaboration with others, quite often abroad, but also with a large number of PhD students, have been very important for me. And having a group working collectively on a certain issue with different aspects, like in that Kestrel Vole work, that was fantastic. The human sleep work with the psychiatry was a fantastic period and a fantastic highlight. The collaboration with Colin Pittenrick, with Jürgen Aschoff, I'll cherish and I'll never forget what fun that was. And building at university a group of people and inspiring them into such action has also been great. And I learned from Jürgen Aschoff that this works even better if you have parties now and then. So we always had our house open for get-togethers after work, but also every summer was punctuated with a big garden party here. So there have been so many fun things which I've been able to do, with support always from friends and family.
When Aschoff left, had to leave the institute because he was living in it, he had a big auction and a big party. There were always parties there, but on this occasion they sold all sorts of junk which they had. But they also sold by auction this bust. And there were two people voting for it. And I was so attached to it, but there was one other person. There was Till Rönneberg from Munich. And we are great friends, but we both wanted to have this to symbolize our continuation of the work of Jürgen Aschoff. And the price went up and up and up. And at some point it went over the 400, and we were the only two. And when I hit 500, Aschoff said, Schluss! Vorbei! Abgelaufen! Serge kriegt den!
Serge Daan, an outstanding scientist. He supervised some 45 PhD students and he published 250 papers. He will be remembered for his contribution to chronobiology. It's a field where many issues remain unsolved.
What sleep does exactly in the brain is not known. And I think that is where the major question is. That's where the future will go to, because we have to know in order to understand the human brain better. I have not seen real progress in recent years. And I think there's still a lot to do there. But it's not so easy. And I have no more time to do something about it myself.